A more recent example of science by consensus is with cold fusion research in the early 80s. My apology for digressing a bit here, but as I'm making a bold accusation against science, I feel the need to provide some bold evidence. In 1989, two distinguished chemists, Dr. Martin Fleischmann and Dr. Stanley Pons, announced they had detected a nuclear reaction that could turn water into a powerful new fuel. Their discovery became known pejoratively as cold fusion because, according to them, it could deliver fusion energy like that produced in the sun without emitting radiation. As you can imagine, this was massive news and pointed to a field of study even less discussed than alchemy, free energy. However, it was also an existential threat to the energy giants who for decades had derived profits from the exploitation of fossil fuels. The U.S. Department of Energy, under the first President Bush, a former oil man, I might add, convened a review panel that invited other mainstream scientists and institutions to review the data. What happened after that left many in the scientific community with a foul taste in their mouth at the direction science was taking. I won't go into the details too much, but a two-pronged effort was made to discredit the data. One was a sudden disclosure by Dr. Stephen Jones, a physicist at Brigham Young University in Utah, that he had also been working on a similar process. His disclosure essentially blocked Pons and Fleischmann from patenting their process and giving it legitimacy. The other was a willful misrepresentation of the data by experts at MIT, raising doubt as to the validity of the claims of free energy. In a surprising conflict of interest, the ensuing scandal ended the careers of Pons and Fleischmann when Dr. Jones called a press conference on behalf of the Department of Energy to first issue an indictment of the Pons and Fleischmann data and then deciding whether or not to further study it by vote. Unsurprisingly, they voted not to, and most people have never heard of this dark moment in science. A dishonest and dangerous precedent had been set for the modern age. The fact remains, however, that most of the scientific assertions placing us on an oblate spheroid, spinning at 1,000 miles per hour, and going around the sun at 67,000 miles per hour, are surprisingly undetectable. Noticing this made me feel two things. One, curious, that maybe the truth about the origin of humankind is something different than what either of these bands has been playing all this time. And two, cautious, because to be a layman, publicly questioning the intellectual heavyweights opens you up to instant ridicule, followed quickly by allegations of the Dunning-Kruger effect, claiming you simply don't know the breadth of what you don't know. To that, I call BS, blind scientism. Because knowing there are gaps in your knowledge, and if you're motivated enough, will instantly orientate you to filling in that specific gap. And it is there, on that path of learning a debatable prerequisite concept, that you most encounter one of these well-meaning smart men playing you a tune you would have never expected from the scientific community. Faith. Look, to explain it to you, I would need to get into a complex mathematical equation that I don't have the time to do and you wouldn't understand anyway, so just trust me. Sounds familiar, right? The lyrics are different, but that melody is unmistakable. And here you find yourself, perhaps feeling a little deja vu. Having just been academically coerced into trusting scientism by the whisper of faith. Though it is curiously never called that. I suppose because the music needs to remain subtle, and calling it faith in scientism would make it far too obvious. Nikola Tesla also noticed this a long time ago. He famously said, Today's scientists have substituted mathematics for experiments, and they wander off through equation after equation and eventually build a structure which has no relation to reality. Perhaps this is why science at large avoids explaining away the idea of Jesus having existed. Perhaps, having long noticed that humanity as a whole doesn't embrace change that well, but will more easily leave a belief in an old perception if a new one is created and built on an independent system of empirical evidence. That people will then willingly make the leap away from spirituality, despite the steep academic barriers calling them to that new evidence. I also want to note that my criticisms here are of scientism and not science itself. Science, when done correctly, is beautiful. Scientism, however, is lazy and seeks to subvert critical thinking, which is too much like organized religion in the past, whom I also have criticisms for. For organized religion, faith was their breakout hit, but not their most famous. Morality holds that title. And while some modern scientists have become smug with their own intellect, organized religion has spent far more time arrogantly looking over its nose at us from this position of unquestionable morality. Despite church figure after church figure being caught doing things most of us wouldn't dream of, still, they too are not monolithic. Does this put their claims of Christ existing into question? I suggest not, but perhaps he has been portrayed differently than how he really was. There is evidence to suggest that some kind of supermen did some super things a long time ago, but I'm more interested in Christ's connection to our notion of morality. See, when Jesus was crucified, Christian doctrine says that many societies had turned away from the morality of the Old Testament. But maybe this was not so. Maybe the common folk of that age were not that different to us today. Perhaps they had chosen not to harm others for reasons less than abject morality. Of course, too, some for whom morality had shifted into a gray area of equivocations, but perhaps they too wondered, why is the rabbi so exalted? After all, he gathers the water in the morning the same as I. How can he know all he says he knows? Maybe the folks back then had seen little tangible evidence of a creator, and instead had made the judgment that it was more beneficial to worry about survival than pleasing said creator. Maybe having seen that, survival often came down to simply not being an asshole. For the sake of this argument, imagine the higher being who had created humanity watching all of this back then. A Hebrew Christian God or some alien being surmising that his guidance was not being heeded. Might they see it as the cost of progress and enlightenment? Or would they know that they could not let it continue? And what would they do about it? Would that God love the human experience enough to offer them a way out? Would that being save their souls from whatever awaited any moral life? And if so, would there be a cost for us involved? After finding no answer to the previous question of why Christ would be offered for our sins, what keeps many modern people comfortable in atheism is the idea that if a God really exists, why does he allow so much suffering in the world? Why didn't God stop that rapist? Why didn't God stop all those children from being murdered? Why doesn't he stop wars? The uncomfortable answer is that it's simply not his job to. It's ours. What atheists often forget is that Christianity and most other religions teach that God gave humans free will, and the choice of whether to be an asshole or not is ours alone to make. Combine that with political power, and you get an idea for the thought process behind some of humanity's most evil decisions.